Track 6. This road's known locally as Ward Lane, and you should continue on it until you reach Stonehaugh in 6 miles' time. The road's a national cycle route in places, and there's likely to be farm traffic, and you might meet logging trucks. It's also quite a narrow road in places, so you'll need to watch out for one of the many designated passing places when traffic's approaching you. In a few miles' time, you'll enter the forest, and shortly after that you'll need to turn off to the right towards Stonehaugh. The way is clearly marked.
This ridge that you climb in now lifts you quite rapidly a good 600 feet above the valley floor, and you're leaving the relatively gentle pastoral landscape behind. Who needs pastoral landscape? You can see pastoral landscapes anywhere. This is Northumberland. You're approaching the real Northumberland, the emptiness and the big skies. I hope you've had a nice time so far, but you have at last left the main roads and the valley behind. For the next 15 miles or so, you'll be up in the hills, and things should become pretty quiet. But not, in my opinion, merely pretty. This landscape has an odd sort of beauty. My background is Cumbrian, and my early experiences of countryside were in the Lake District, with its mighty crags and precipitous valleys. And when I first came here, it took me quite a while to start appreciating the less dramatic wildness of the northeast. I appreciate it now, though. I can't imagine anywhere more beautiful. There might not be any mighty mountains in Northumberland, but the border hills seem to roll on forever, ridge after ridge after ridge. For a little while, the ridge you're on is lined or partly lined with trees and little blocks of commercial woodland. But as you leave the trees behind, you'll soon begin to catch glimpses of the wider landscape. To the south of you, the moors stretch back to the Roman wall, across a little known and little visited landscape. To the north, the hills just seem to go on forever. It's a big county, Northumberland. I believe it's the fifth biggest in England, but in comparison to the size, its population is tiny, and most of them live on Tyneside. Out here, on the northwestern edge of the county, there are more sheep than people, and the emptiness can feel quite profound. However, this high, empty and wild landscape is not quite what it seems. It looks simple, it looks big and empty, and it's difficult to imagine that it's ever been anything different. But the story is quite a bit more complicated. In the distant past, for example, in the years after the last ice age, about 10,000 years ago, the landscape was covered with forest, and the first humans who settled here were hunter-gatherers in the forest. But gradually, from about 5,000 years ago, humans have been settling here, cutting down the trees, planting crops and raising stock. And by the time the Romans arrived, the hills were quite a bit busier than they are now. I remember talking to one landowner close to here, and he told me that there were hundreds of prehistoric sites that had already been recorded by archaeologists on his land, but that he had ridden over every inch of his estate on horseback, and he reckoned that not one in ten had so far been identified. He was convinced that his moors must have been quite densely populated back in the Bronze Age. Some of the ancient sites are around you now. Quite soon, possibly even as we speak, you'll pass a dramatic set of crags called Ravenshoof Crags on the left-hand side of the road. Beside them is a little group of four standing stones. They were the base of a Bronze Age burial cairn, 2,500 years old. But one of the stones is older still. It's covered with cup and ring markings, which are thousands of years older, even than the Bronze Age. It was carved in the Stone Age, probably reused by the Bronze Age builders because of its ancient religious significance. So, the wild emptiness that you see now isn't natural. It's the product of thousands of years of man's interaction with the landscape. And of course, as you should see quite soon, the interaction is still going on. In fact, recently it's been going in the opposite direction. Because on this section of the trip you will be entering a new forest, a man-made forest, the Kielder Forest, or initially at least a bit of it, which is called the Wark Forest. Before you enter it, you'll catch glimpses of its size, great dense blocks of green rolling off into the distance. It all belongs to the Forestry Commission, which was set up in 1919, just after the First World War, to try and stop the country being too dependent on imports for its vital supplies of timber. The forests up here in North Tynedale weren't begun until the 1920s, and in fact the major development started after 1930, when the 8th Duke of Northumberland died and the government took his estates up here in lieu of death duties. Since then, they've created the largest man-made forest in Europe, with apparently 150 million trees, give or take one or two. The sort of traditional view of the Forestry Commission is that they planted vast, dense stands of dark imported conifer trees like Sitka spruce, and you'll still see plenty of that sort of planting. Right from the start of entering the forest, there's planting like that. But in more recent years, the situation has begun to change. And you'll see the changes too as you approach Stonehaugh. The Commission has embraced biodiversity as a concept, for example, so there are far more native species of tree being planted, and trees which create suitable habitats for wildlife. They also harvest the trees differently. Before, everything was planted at the same time, and 45 years later it was all cleared at the same time. The stumps would be left to rot, and the cycle would begin all over again. Wildlife can't settle in conditions like that, and it looks ugly too. So nowadays there's far more of what you might call silviculture, tree management, so that individual trees are selected for felling under continuous cover, which allows for much more continuity of the habitat and creates much more attractive places for humans to enjoy as well, because human recreation has become another big theme in the forest. But maybe we'll come back to that a bit more when we get nearer to Kielder. Before that, you'll get to the village of Stonehaugh, which is an odd place. It's like a 1950s housing estate in the forest. Well, in fact, what it is a 1950s housing estate in the forest. It was designed by an extremely influential mid-20th century planner called Thomas Sharp to provide accommodation for the workers in the new forest. In fact, he designed 8 villages, but only 3 were ever built. There were Stonehaugh and Kielder, and another at Burness on the A68, and none of them was ever finished. He was furious, actually. He intended them to have all sorts of services as well as houses, but they were never provided, because the Commission realised that they'd overestimated the number of workers needed. It was all a bit unsatisfactory, and I suspect that there was a lot of disappointment and rural isolation. But in the 1980s, the village was tarted up, made much prettier with nice paint jobs, and a wider range of people were encouraged to live here. To be honest, I don't know what it's like as a place to live, but it looks nice, and somebody local has carved some totem poles and put them beside the picnic area at the far end of the village, which gives it a certain sense of place. From the car park, there's easy access to beautiful forest walks and to the dramatic mini-gorges of the peaty brown wax burn which passes through the village. Now, I think it's fair to say that not many 50s council estates have got a better setting.
OK, continue on to Stonehaugh, and when you're there, move on to Track 7.